Hi, everybody. Welcome to tonight's Tigerland football show. Last week, we finished up with all the seniors that we had out for football. I think there was 20 of them in all. And tonight is our guest. We've got Bob Motter, our activities director. And most of you know Bob, but in a little bit, we'll visit with him. And he'll also give us some insight on some of the administrative things as far as the playoff game goes that will be tomorrow night. First, we'll talk a little bit about the game up at Columbus. We got up there at about 5:30, and the wind was howling. It was colder than heck. And luckily, by 7:30, the wind had died down quite a bit. And they said the wind chill factor was still like at about 10 or 12 degrees. It didn't seem quite that cold, at least on the sidelines. It might for you people that went up there and watched the game. But the kids got off to kind of a cold start. We talked about after the game with the newspaper people that we really didn't think that we had that competitive edge mentally. Columbus ended up scoring on us first. We get a score in the second quarter to make it 7-7 at halftime. They kick a field goal right at the beginning of the fourth quarter, and then we have to put together a 75-yard drive for the go-ahead touchdown, and then to boot, hold them on a fourth and short later in the right at the end of the game. So it was a hard-fought game. We knew Columbus would have an excellent football team. As Mr. Madero and I were talking this morning and looking at Columbus' schedule, they played six different teams that were rated at one time in the top 10 in Nebraska. So, you know, their schedule really was against them this year, and they do have some real fine football players. And we'll see that game film, as usual, towards the end of the show. Right now, we'll visit with Bob a little bit. Many of you don't realize the hours that Mr. Madero spends up here. He is up here most of the time whenever the coaches are up here, and then a lot of time on his own. There's always something to do. And something else that a lot of people don't realize, that not only does he take care of the athletics, but he takes care of all the other activities too. The band and the drama and all the different organizations that we have throughout our school, and they are many. So his hours are long, and he's very organized, and I know from the football coaches anyway, we sure appreciate the effort that he gives us. He's involved with our booster club, hand-in-hand working with them, and there's just a lot of things that he's involved with. Tonight, basically, we asked him to come on to visit with you people about what's going to happen for the playoff game. Most of you probably already know the game time, but I'm going to turn that over to Bob and let him talk a little bit about what's going to happen tomorrow night for our playoff game.
Okay, like Coach Olson said, the playoff game, of course, is Wednesday tomorrow night at 6 o'clock at Hastings College Field. The gates will open at 4:45. This being a state tournament game, an NSAA game, no activity tickets, booster tickets, complimentary tickets, things of that nature can be accepted. We have been selling tickets in the senior high office the last 2 days, and on Monday was the last day I checked, and in the first day of sales, we had sold about $1,400 worth of tickets already, you know, so we've got a lot of people coming, you know, without knowing what Tuesday and Wednesday sales are, and then of course the sales at the gate. Admission is $3 for students and $4 for adults. This is probably, you know, this is the first time Hastings High School has been involved in the football playoffs. I have been involved in the playoffs before, as Coach Olson has, but this is the first time that I have hosted a playoff game. I think maybe looking back on it, we were kind of fortunate with our Kearney game 2 weeks ago. You know, everything that we did for the Kearney game, and things ran pretty smooth with the big crowd that we have there. We have just carried over to Wednesday night's game, and we'll do everything the same. You know, the snow fence is still up. We left it up at the field for the Hastings Dome game this coming Saturday. Fans who can't get a seat in the stadium, you know, the two stadiums together only seat 2,100 people, but fans can stand around the in the end zone behind the snow fences and along the fences like we did with the Kearney game. We expect another real good crowd, and of course, you know, we expect another real good football game.
Bob, what do you think is going to be the best bet for parking? I know over there our parking situation isn't great, but what do you suggest for the fans that are coming from our side?
Well, it's, you know, the same thing. Again, like Coach Olson said, you know, and as I think probably everybody here in Hastings knows, there are no parking lots around the field. It is all on-street parking. we ask again, like we always have, that Hastings fans park on the west side of the field and come in through the west gates. Now, Monday's Tribune said to that Hastings fans should park on the east side, but I think everybody probably knows that when they read it that was a mistake and that Hastings fans should park on the west side.
Okay. You know, and it's going to be a situation, I'm sure, where you're going to want to get there early. It was amazing for the Kearney game when the kids got out there to warm up. You know, the stands themselves were already packed and people were starting to stand around the areas that Bob was talking about. So I'm sure it's going to be the same situation. It sounds like the weather is going to be kind of cooperative with us on Wednesday, at least from right now. And hopefully those sort of things will go well. Mr. Monroe, setting football aside, why don't you quickly run through, if you don't mind, some of the other things that you're staying busy with right now during this time?
Well, you know, at this time, of course, you know, we're wrapping up the fall sports season and getting the winter season started. We have, you know, just some other things that I'm involved in. You know, we have parent-teachers conferences on Tuesday and Thursday. You know, we have Thanksgiving coming up, you know, with the start of winter sports practice when you get a long break right before, you know, a week before the first game, you know, kind of runs into some problems and some concerns with coaches all the time. But our four winter coach sports is, you know, Coach Sajovic, Coach Nelson, Coach Sheely, and Coach Zeppelin, you know, all seem to handle those things on their own pretty well. Of course, you know, we're hiring right now, you know, we're hiring officials for winter sports next year, a year from now. Of course, the big thing that's going on right now is reclassification. We've got a district meeting coming up, and then we're going to have an NSAA district meeting coming up, and then we'll have another meeting of the new Class B schools probably a week after that. So right now, you know, I've been spending a lot of time on the road and a lot of time on the telephone talking about reclassification, you know, doing some lobbying for things that we want to have here in Hastings, particularly head-to-head competition in the districts. You know, and of course we've got, you know, we're getting into a busy time for band concerts. We had the vocal concert last week, and we've got the Christmas concert coming up in, what, about 3 weeks from now. We've got the play coming up in another week. District volleyball, state volleyball tournaments, you know, just all kinds of things. There are always a lot of things going on. I've said for years I don't work very hard, but I work long.
Well, that gives you a little bit of an idea of what Bob is doing right now. And as he rattled through all those things, that, you know, sometimes I think we're busy during football season, the football coaches, and of course we are. But listening to Bob, it almost seems like it's football season all year round for him. And he is right. He's worked some long hours, and obviously he's got a good wife at home, Eve, that knows what's going on and knows the hours that it takes. And as I said earlier, we appreciate everything. And a lot of Mr. Monroe's work is done behind the scenes. You know, when you come to the football game or you come to the concert or whatever activity you come to, everything's already been set up. And yes, the directors of those activities are doing, you know, their part, but a large part is the coordination of all those things. I know just for our home football games, you know, you've got crowd control and concessions, and it's endless. The officials making sure everything is ready and just going right down the list. So there are a lot of things, and I know a lot of times the average fan doesn't see those. And Bob, we appreciate you, what you do here for our high school, and we also appreciate taking time out tonight and getting on the show. So with that, we will pause here momentarily, and when we come back, we will take a look at the Columbus football game from last Friday night. Okay, game opens up, and we receive the opening kickoff. About, I think, only the third time this year that happens. This is Mike Kehoe returning to football, and on this first return, we really get a good return. Mike follows some good blocking, and gets the ball out a little better. On our next two returns, we don't do quite as well. We open up the first series with a motion with our two tight ends set, and that's Brad Seiler going in motion. We run a little flood pattern, And the ball just skips off Brad's, I think it skipped off his fingers, or it might have been a little high. I really can't remember. I know it was a real quick pass and looked like we had an opening there, but we don't come up with it. Second down, we run a trap to Kelly Wiesman, and our trap was very effective the other night, as it has been the last couple weeks. And Kelly picks up enough for the first down. Out of our twin set, we'll run the little circle pattern, and Bo's got a check to our fullback, who's an outlet receiver, and Kelly can't hold on to the football. So we're 0 for 2 in the passing department again, right off the bat. Here we run a power play off of our strong set. And that's Kelly Wiesman carrying again. Josh Cole leading the blocking for him. We pick up about 6 or 7. Brings up our first third down play of the night. And we run counter sweep out of a Husker set. And don't do a real good job of it. So it brings up a punting situation. And Darius is back to punt with Trent Clark snapping for him. We did pick up a first down in that drive, but would like to be able to pick up several more to gain at least some field position. Our goal when we get the football is, if we do have to turn it over, we would like to be able to turn it over with them having to start from at least a 20. So we're a little bit too far out, and they open up their drive 10 yards further out than we'd like to see them. Now, they put together a nice little drive here. They run some things that we had not seen them be real effective with during the year. They weren't a big option team all year long, but apparently they saw some things that in the films against us that they wanted to do. And this play right here, we defend it well here, but it turns out to be a big play for them throughout the night. They get a lot of people in their sweep, and sometimes that is hard to defend. Here they come back with the option again. And I believe their quarterback gets enough to pick up that first down for them. They had some motion penalties. Both teams were plagued with some motion penalties throughout the night. Here they come back with a counter sweep pass, and that's Nate Friesen that gets in there and just barely puts a glove on him, but it was enough. I believe he grabbed him by the shoulder pad and comes up with a sack for us. So that puts them into a long yardage situation, and they're out in their trip set. And we really have this pattern covered well and had defensed it well all week in practice, but their quarterback just makes a perfect pass. Spala puts it in there right where it needs to be. Okay, now there we did not have bad coverage on that play. We had Corey Dreher, our corner, come up and really read it and play it well, but he just didn't make the tackle. Here they run a power off the other side, and again, we've got a middle linebacker right where he's supposed to be. But when you miss tackles, people, you're not going to stop many teams. Here they give it to their big fullback. They had a big old fullback, about 2 1/4. Not extremely fast, but ran hard, and when it was short yardage, they were going to give it to him. They come back with their motion out of their power eye and run the sweep. And we do a little better job of defending it there, but they pick up enough for the first down. It was 3rd and short. Option out of the power eye. And we are very, very fortunate here because we have a breakdown in our coverage. On that particular defensive scheme, our outside linebacker is to be on the pitch. And as you can see, Josh decided he was going to take the quarterback instead. Luckily, we had a clip, and on the clip, the play was brought back. Here they run counter sweep pass, and we've got 2 or 3 Tiger defenders back there. It's Mike Tossin that just about intercepts the football. They're unbalanced line now, and again, they had some sort of either illegal formation or some movement up front. Trip set again. This time, again, we've got it covered perfectly, and they throw it. It's a little too high to catch. Over there on that side, that's Nick Tripe and Ben Butenbach, our underneath linebackers. Now, here's a play that they ran effectively all night against us. I believe they 3 big times, and you'll see them coming up here. It's a little tight end counter, and we had worked on it during the week, but apparently not well enough because they do it 3 times to us. I think they come right back with it here, and what they're doing is influencing our defensive tackle out, trapping him, and then in that Tiger set when we have just one middle backer, our middle backer early in the game was not reading it correctly and was taking himself out of the play. So they have put together a nice little drive, even overcoming that 15-yard penalty, and the quarterback takes it in on an option. So things don't look real good for the Tigers right now. Columbus makes it look very easily. Little problem with the snap, but their holder does a nice job, and Columbus is up 7-0. Now, last week going into the game, we were a little weary of how would we respond to a team that whose record, you know, is only 2-6, 2-7 now, but 2-6 at the time, but a good 2-7 team. They played six teams that were in the top 10 in Class A. And, you know, anytime you're playing a schedule like that, here Bo Buitenbeck gets loose on what we call our 45 follow. It starts out looking like an option, and we get a fake to our fullback. And Bo, instead of taking it outside, cuts it up right behind the fullback, and that's been effective for us. Here we run counter sweep again, and apparently they had decided with their defensive scheme that they were going to try to take that play away from us. Little toss sweep that was effective against Kearney is does a pretty nice job here again against Columbus, and that was the last play of the first quarter. Now there we have a penalty. They said that our right guard, Larry Brown, was lined up in the neutral zone. Here we run a pattern that's designed to separate our tight end and our wide receiver. And our wide receiver was supposed to run a smash route, what we call a smash route, which is a 6x6 comeback. And he was way, way too narrow. And what you saw there were two receivers about in the same area, which ends up putting, you know, two or three defenders in the same area. And anytime you have that happen, your chances of being successful are slim. So we have to punt the ball away. Now, we had a bad break here. They definitely fumbled the football, and we definitely recovered it. But the official over on their sideline, who is a good official, we have him at home, said that he felt the ball was fumbled after the runner went down. Well, it was very obvious that he was still up when he fumbled the football, but again, that's the breaks. Here they come back and run a little lead option again, and we've got some people there. I think they pick up one or two on the play. Running a lot of wing and a lot of power sets. Here they run the tight end counter again. And I think they got more yardage out of that play, that particular play, than any play that they ran. They ended up, I believe, with 173 yards rushing and about 27 yards passing on us. And I bet they had 55 or 60. Here we come up with a big, big, big play. The right side of our line, Larry Brown, and I believe that's Danny Farrell over there. We're tugging at the football. Justin May got his hands in on it. And we recover a football, and that's a break for us, because if they put together another drive and go down and score to go up 14, we're looking at some trouble. Here we run counter sweep out of our trip set. Breaks for about 5 or 6 yards. That's Josh Cole carrying, and behind Raleigh White and Justin May. Again, David Beattie's at center, been our center all year. And Brown at the right guard, and Eric Kump at our tackle spot. So our lineup has remained pretty constant. Here we run a straight dive with some wedge blocking on third and short, but don't come up with enough for the first down. So again, the Tigers are forced to punt. Here we ask Darius to angle that football, and he does a great, great job of giving us a coffin corner kick, and he gets it down inside the 10. I believe it went all the way like to the 7 or 8 yard line with no return, and that's a big, big play for us. So now, you know, at least we're meeting one of our goals when we get the football. Be able to punt the ball and make them start inside the 20. Larry Brown comes up with a big play. Right about that time, Coach Sheely was telling us on the sideline he felt Larry was starting to come alive. Kevin Fisher now is playing one of our corners, and it was great to see Kevin back in there. Corey Dreher had received a concussion in the game and was forced out of the game, obviously. And we've got Kevin Fisher in there. And here Kevin comes up with a big interception for us. And as I said, it was nice to see not only Kevin in the game, he's been out ever since the North Platte game, but really making a major contribution. And we used him mostly on defense the other night, but he did get some offense. Here we ran a trap out of a different set, and our back gets outside the trap block. He actually missed the trap block. We thought the block was there. So now we're in our spread set, and we run a quarterback draw, and Bo does most of that work on his own. As you saw, there was two or three tacklers hanging on him, and he just powered out of it. Here we're forced to waste a timeout because we don't get in a proper alignment, and Bo does a smart thing. Rather than take the penalty, use a timeout. But later that comes back to haunt us because we could have used a timeout later and didn't have any left. Trap out of our Tiger set. That's Kelly running extremely hard behind some good trap blocking. I believe that time it was Larry Brown running the trap block. Raleigh ran several throughout the game. Here we run counter sweep, and Josh makes that look pretty easy. He is really turning into a fine back for us. And with Kevin back healthy now, there are times when we'll put him and Kevin in the backfield at the same time. Aaron puts it through. Aaron's been much more consistent. He did miss the one in the Kearney game, but has been much more consistent in the second half of the season. We're glad to see that. Here we get our squib kick, and we would like to see that squib kick kicked a little bit deeper. The idea is right to get it bouncing and floating around, but we'd like to see it a little deeper because we'd like them to have to pick it up around the 20, inside the 20. Here they come back with option, and that's a nice play by Josh Cole. Now, on that particular play, earlier we said Josh had tackled the quarterback and wasn't the right job, but on that particular scheme that Coach Zeppelin had sent in, Josh was responsible for the quarterback. Here, Justin May buries their running back for a big play. So we're starting to heat up on defense a little bit. Here they come back with the old nemesis trap, or a sweep. And I was trying to see what defensive backs those were, but I couldn't tell, but there were several backs in on the play. So we forced them into their first punt. And that's Mike Kehoe receiving the punt. That might have been Kevin Fisher that time. Kevin's back there now since Corey is out with an injury, at least last week. Corey's back practicing with us. Nick Tripe got injured. He's back practicing with us, so we're at full strength. Here we open up with counter sweep again and get some good yardage. We're right at the end of the half, and we give Kevin a shot at the counter sweep, his first big offensive play since coming back from his injury, and halftime runs out. A short little blurb in the film there. I'm not sure why. But, Mr. Richmond and Andy Richmond have been doing our filming all year, and they're the reason why our films come out so well. We do have nice equipment that the Booster Club has purchased for us to use, but I'll tell you, you have to have good filmers. And ever since I've got here, Mr. Richmond has done the filming, and Andy's been doing the far view for a couple years for us, and next year, with Andy moving up to the varsity, we're going to have to find a new filmer to do that far view. Second half opens up with us kicking off to them. Score 7-7 now. They come right back with their sweep, and as you can see, we get more people there, but missed tackles. A lot of people were asking after the game and since the game, did we think that the cold weather had anything to do with it? And I really don't think that is a good excuse. It was just as cold for them as it was for us. They're a great play by the left side of our line and our middle backers. Short yardage situation, and we hold them to about a half a yard, but they only needed a quarter of a yard. Their big fullback again plunges up. Here, we force them into a situation. I'm not exactly sure it was a broken play or what, but we had two defensive linemen bust through real quick, both our tackles, and get a hold of that quarterback before he could do anything. Here they try the tight end counter again, and we finally stop it. Zeppelin felt a little relieved about that. I sure did. Toss sweep, getting a lot of people out in front. And there we had a great job by our outside backer in our corner. Come up and make, make a great play on third down. So they're forced to punt to us again. We do a good job of catching the ball, as we've done all year. And the Tigers take over. Trap to Wiesman for about four. Bo scrambles and picks up a few good yards for us. So we're third down again. This time we run the follow play, and we decide to go for it on fourth down. And we run our lead, and Josh picks up enough behind Kelly for the first down. Now, at the time, that's, I guess probably a chancy call, but we felt we could get the yard. Glad we made it. Here, Bo does a nice job of finding Mike Kehoe on our X curl route. Brings up second and short. And we run, come back with a counter sweep. That's Raleigh White and Justin May leading the blocking. They've done a good job on blocking that counter sweep for us. And, of course, our backs have done a good job running it. Here now we actually have an open receiver. Josh was open in the flat, and Bo decides for some reason not to throw it to him and check off to Kelly again. It's a little bit low, and Kelly can't hold on to it. We come back with counter sweep pass. And we do have an open receiver, but the pass is underthrown and too low. So we go into our trip set, and it was an automatic hot pattern there because we had a receiver that was uncovered, but the quarterback gets the ball too high, and it's picked off. So they start. We know they're going to run sweep. We're doing some things to try to counter that, but this is a very good football team that we're playing. Very, not indicative by the record at all, as we talked about earlier. Six of the teams that they played this year were rated in the top 10 in Nebraska. Several of the teams that they played are in the playoffs: Southeast, us, Lincoln Pius, and Kearney. All playoff, four of the eight playoff teams were on their schedule this year. So they're a good football team. They played a lot of juniors, and they're going to be someone to reckon with next year. There's a great play by the Tigers there on that toss. I anticipate seeing a lot of this type of stuff from Pompillion this week. Obviously, they were at the game the other night. They saw what Columbus was doing. They do, too, have a powerful running game. The thing that makes them a little more worrisome is that they've got an excellent, excellent passing game. Probably the best passing game in the state. Here's something that happens and it looks like it's pretty well covered, but what they did, and the people up in the box picked it up, but we didn't get it relayed to the kids in time, and no one on the field picked it up, but they took their quarterback, put him at that I back position, brought in another quarterback, pitched it to the I back, and had him throw it back. And we should have picked that up out on the field. Here again, great coverage. But as you can see, the Discoverers are down on about the 20, 25-yard line now. Here comes that tight end counter, and our linebacker's there. Does a better job. So they're going to attempt about a 35-yard field goal. And the kid kicks it very well, and that puts Columbus up 10-7. Notice a switch of quarters, so the fourth quarter is just beginning. And over on the sideline, we challenge those offensive linemen and offensive players now to get something done. We didn't feel they were performing very well overall. Stubbing our toes. We're coming up with some big plays, but then making some not-so-good plays, too. So we told them we were going to get down the business and try to get after them. We had about 10, 11 minutes. We wanted to get down to a good running attack.
On first down, we pick up about 7 or 8. Here we run an outside dive to Josh, and he picks up 3 or 4, enough for the first down. Trap to Kelly. Again, when we're picking up 5 and 6 on a trap, that's a play that we like to stay with. Kelly, the last 3 or 4 games, has run very, very hard, and of course, we're getting some good work out of our line. Here's a little toss sweep that was real effective for us in the Kearney game, and Josh does a great job of following some good blocking by our two pulling guards, but also gets about 10 extra yards on his own. And that's a sign of a good back, and that's why we said earlier, Josh is really turning into a fine back. Kelly busts up the middle for about 4 more on a trap. Counter sweep back the other way. Josh decides to cut it up early. And Honest Cut picks up enough, just about the first down. We go ahead and trap it on 3rd and short this time, and the Tigers are rolling. And we're doing it in a good old-fashioned way, a good ground game. Here, Bo audibles to a play that we had been waiting for them to get into one particular defense, and great audible, and Ben is wide open. The ball's maybe just a little overthrown, but Ben stumbles, and as he's going down, can't hold on to it. But a great job of seeing the audible, executing it. We just wish we could have held on to the football. Again, you can see a trap block there by Larry Brown. So we're down inside the 20, moving the ball pretty much at will now. And why we're doing that now and didn't do it earlier, you don't really know. And on counter sweep again, Josh takes it down to about the 1 yard line. It looked like he scored, but the official said he was down early and he was right there. So we get in our goal line package, and Kelly throws a nice block, and Josh finds a way to get in. So they responded very well to the challenge that we gave them on the sideline. Now we've got to see if the Tigers can come out and hold them. Aaron's kick's a little low, but it does find a way through. 14-10. Kick was very important there. Now they've got to score a touchdown to beat us. A field goal will not do any good. Here again, we squib it, but Aaron didn't get a good squib kick. He kicks it way too short. They get the ball on the 35-yard line. And as we've talked about all year, our goal is to get it, keep them inside the 30. They come out and run dive option, a play that they had not shown very much throughout the year. And they pick up 5 yards on first down. Counter sweep, defensed about as well as you can. That's Josh Cole, Ben Butenbach, and Nate Friesen in on the stop. Here comes that lead option that gave us some problems earlier. We do a little better job of it there. Brings up 4th and short, and they've got to go for it. They give it to the big fullback, and they pick up the yardage again. They run outside this time on their toss, and we seemingly have them stopped on the line of scrimmage, but a great job by their back. They had 2 good junior backs, and those 2 kids played against us the first game of the year against our JVs. And now they're starting in with their varsity, and they'll be back next year, and they'll be tough. Here option with a fire call on, and that is a nice play by our defensive back to come up and make the tackle from 8 or 10 yards deep on the pitch man. Here they come sweep to the short side, and again, get some good play. That's Ben Butenbach making the tackle, but that's Josh Cole taking out most of the interference. So there on 4th and short, I don't know if it was a fumbled snap, but there certainly was something that wasn't right. And on 4th and short, the Tigers come up with a big, big play. Okay, we're running out of our power trip set. Toss the ball to Josh. What we need to do now is get one first down for sure. One first down for sure, because they have several timeouts left, and you can't tell on the film when they're using those timeouts, but they are using them. We run an ISO out of our I formation. Don't use that I formation a great deal, but there are times when we think it is very effective. Now we come back up with counter sweep on third down and fake it and run the pass. And Bo just makes a very good decision. And everybody's covered, and he takes it upfield for a big, big first down. Counter sweep to Josh. And we decide to run the clock out with just two victory snaps, and the football game is over. And Tigers come out with a 14-10 victory. Now, we talked a little bit about the playoff game earlier, and Mr. Modero filled you in on all the information that you need. We are expecting a very tough opponent. We don't get to see fans-wise and coaches-wise too much of the Omaha Metro teams. Last week, we were fortunate enough to have a fella here in town that on both Wednesday and Thursday nights after we were done practice, flew us down to do some scouting. We did have an opportunity to see Papillion in person. We also exchanged three or four game films with their coaching staff, and so we've had a chance to look at them, and they run a very diversified offense, and they are very quick, probably more speed than we've seen on a team, in general throughout the year. Kearney probably would come closer than anybody as far as generating team speed like Papillion has. They've always been a great passing team, a lot of short passes. They'll use their power running game and trapping running game, and then throw a lot of the short passes, and they're very, very well coached. Coach Sewer's had some state championships. I believe they've been in the playoffs, I'm guessing the last 8 or 10 years in a row. It's hard to remember a year when Papillion hasn't been in the playoffs. So we're expecting a very tough game. The kids are preparing well, and we've had a couple great, great nights of practice, and we'll be ready to get after it on Wednesday night. We hope we have the same type of crowd that we had there for the Kearney game, and we'll talk to you at least one more time next week.